Well, I think we can start. There is going to be standing room only from now on. So rather than have people stand for too long, we'll get going. And we hope everybody enjoys this evening. My name is Miroslav Shkandri. I'm in the Department of German and Slavic Studies. I'd like to welcome everybody here. On behalf of the organizers, this is the 20th annual J.B. Rudnyckyj Distinguished Lecture. And this time around, we have cooperated and collaborated with a couple of institutions outside the university. The J.B. Rudnyckyj Lecture is organized jointly by the University of Manitoba's Archives and Special Collections, by the Slavic Collection of the Elizabeth Dayfull Library, and also by the Department of German and Slavic Studies. But this particular lecture also is sponsored and supported by the Consulate General of the Republic of Poland in Toronto, and by the Canadian Polish Congress Manitoba branch. So we're very grateful for everybody for cooperating and helping to make this a successful evening. I would like to also recognize a couple of people in the audience. I'm most pleased to state that Grażyna Galanzowski is here. She's the president of the Canadian Polish Congress Manitoba branch. I should also mention that Oksana Bondarchuk, president of the Ukrainian Canadian Congress Manitoba branch, is also here. And I also recognize Bill Balan, who is the vice president of the University of Winnipeg, our sister institution, who's also here, and various other people. I can't possibly mention everybody here, but thank you all for coming out and making this splendid occasion. Timothy Snyder is a professor of history at Yale University. He specializes in the political history of Central and Eastern Europe. He was born and educated in southwestern Ohio and received his BA from Brown University and his doctorate from the University of Oxford in 1997, where he was the British Marshall Scholar. He has also held fellowships in Paris, in Warsaw, at Harvard, where he was an Academy Scholar. A frequent guest at the Institute for Human Sciences in Vienna, he has spent 10 years, or approximately 10 years, in Europe. He speaks several languages, 5 I am told, and reads 10 European languages. And this is evident in his research. He's one of not many scholars who include in their research texts in not just in French, German, Spanish, but also in Polish, Russian, Ukrainian, and other languages. Among his publications are 5 award-winning books, all of which have been translated. Probably the best known are The Reconstruction of Nations, Poland, Ukraine, Lithuania, Belarus, which was published in 2003, Sketches from a Secret War, A Polish Artist's Mission to Liberate Soviet Ukraine, published in 2005, The Red Prince, The Secret Lives of a Habsburg Archduke in 2008, and, of course, most recently, Bloodlands, Europe Between Hitler and Stalin, which was published in 2010. This, as you know, is a book about the Nazi and Soviet mass killings on the lands between Berlin and Moscow. It's a very important book, and it has had a great resonance, and has contributed to rethinking and reconceptualizing East European history and the fate of the peoples on these lands. Bloodlands has won 7 awards, including the Emerson Prize in the Humanities, Arts and Letters Award from the American Academy of Arts and Letters, the Leipzig Award for European Understanding. It has been translated, if you can believe it, into 23 languages. I should also mention that a couple of Professor Snyder's books, a couple other books by Professor Snyder have been translated into 12 languages each. Bloodlands was named to 12 Book of the Year lists, has been a bestseller in 4 countries. And most recently, Professor Snyder has helped the late Tony Judd compose a thematic intellectual history entitled Thinking the 20th Century, which has just appeared. And in fact, in the latest issue of the New York Review of Books, there's a section republished from this book, plus an article about Tony Judd and the writing of this book. Professor Snyder is also the co-editor of 2 volumes, Wall Around the West, State Borders and Immigration Controls in Europe and North America from 2000, and Stalinism in Europe, Terror, War, and Domination, which is to appear next year. He is at work on 2 more books, one a study of the Holocaust and the other a global history of Eastern Europe. He, of course, has published many, many scholarly articles in various journals, past and present, the Journal of Cold War Studies, the New York Review of Books, Foreign Affairs, the Times Literary Supplement, The Nation, The New Republic, The New York Times, and so on. He takes regular part in conferences on Holocaust education and sits on editorial boards of the Journal of Modern European History and East European Politics and Society. A member of the Committee on Conscience of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, he sits on the advisory councils of the Ivo Institute for Jewish Research, the Association for Slavic, East European, and Eurasian Studies, and other organizations. He's a much sought-after speaker, as you can imagine. He's had a significant influence on scholarship dealing with Eastern Europe, and continues to have a significant impact on this scholarship, bringing new understanding to Slavic studies, to the way we think about the 20th century in general. I'm therefore extremely pleased, delighted to welcome Professor Timothy Snyder.
Thank you very much, Professor Scandalli, and thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure to be here in Winnipeg. I'm going to start from the people who are the real subject of this book. Oops. That's cool. In early March 1933, a Ukrainian man, or a man in Soviet Ukraine, let's say, dug his own grave. He dug his own grave for a reason that many of us will find readily apparent. He knew, he saw all around him that hundreds of thousands, indeed by that point a couple of million people, had starved to death in Soviet Ukraine. But there's a deeper reason, I think, why he dug his own grave. He dug his own grave for reasons having to do with dignity, or really indignity. If you starve to death in Soviet Ukraine during that campaign of collectivization and deliberate hunger, your body fell by the roadside or in a field and would be gathered up along with dozens of other bodies when horse-drawn carts went by, and it would be thrown, buried together with other people you didn't know in a mass grave somewhere where your friends and family would never find it if you had friends and family after the starvation. So he dug his own grave, and when the time came, he found it. In April of 1940, a Polish officer was keeping a diary. The previous year, of course, Poland had been invaded from both sides, by the Wehrmacht from the west, by the Red Army from the east. The Red Army had taken several tens of thousands of prisoners of war. Generally, they'd let the enlisted men go, but they'd kept the officers. This man was one of the officers. He kept his diary as he was held in a prisoner of war camp, and he kept it as he was transported by train and by bus to a place which would be later infamous, under the name of Katyn. He kept it right up to the day when he was shot by the NKVD. And in the second to last entry, he wrote, "They asked for my wedding ring, which I," and then it trails off. And we might think he couldn't write any more because he was thinking of his love for his wife, but I don't think that was it. He knew that what the NKVD was doing was collecting valuables before they executed prisoners. He didn't want them to find the wedding ring, so he didn't write where it was in the diary. But of course he was executed, and of course the ring was found, but the diary remained. In September of 1942 in Kovo, which is now, as you will all know, a town in western Ukraine, Volhynia, the remaining Jews of the town, most of them were locked inside the synagogue, barred from the outside, the synagogue was. And it was far enough along in the war, far enough along in the events that we call the Holocaust, that these Jews knew what was going to happen to them. They knew they would be taken out and shot. Of course, the Holocaust in this part of the world was carried out generally by shooting. So they left messages. They with bits of porcelain or glass or gravel, they scratched messages on the walls of the synagogue where they were later found. One young woman left a message to her mother. She was there with her two younger sisters, and she left a message for her mother, which read, "We're sorry we can't be with you," which might seem like a strange thing to say, but of course, at precisely in times like these, people do want to be with their families. And she finished the message, "We kiss you over and over." The problem with writing a book such as this one, or of reading a book such as this one, or of thinking about the book, the events that this book treats, is that these are three of 14 million stories. Really, these are just fragments of three stories, and there are 14 million more. The subject of my book is the deliberate murder of some 14 million men, women, and children, non-combatants, between 1933 and 1945. Now, I hope that number, I trust that number, 14 million, makes a kind of impression. It should make an impression, I think. There has never been a moral and demographic crisis, catastrophe like that in European history. Never have so many people been deliberately killed so quickly, and hopefully never will so many people be killed so quickly again. Clearly, this is an event which is deserving of attention. It's deserving of attention because of the terrible weight of all of these individual tragedies, but I think it's also deserving of attention for what it might teach us about the two regimes involved. These 14 million people were killed by the Nazi or the Stalinist regimes. What's interesting about this is that if you look at those two regimes, so assume that we're concerned, as I'm sure you are, with the history of these regimes. Assume that we're concerned, as I'm sure you are, with why these regimes were so lethal. If you look at the history of these regimes in their entire territorial extension, the two of them together, right, from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean, from Normandy, say, to Siberia in 1940 or 41, 42. The two of them killed between the years 1933 and 1945 about 17 million people, a huge figure. But of that 17 million, 14 million were killed in this relatively small band of territory that I'm talking about, the relatively small bit of territory that I call the Bloodlands. In today's geography, Western Russia, Ukraine, Belarus, Poland, the Baltic states. So if we're concerned about the victims, as we should be, or if we're interested in the regimes and why they were so lethal, as again we should be, this bit of territory becomes terribly important because it's where most of the victims died and it's where most of the victims were killed, right? Looking at it from both sides of the question. And if we contemplate this region, we notice some very interesting things about it. The first thing about it I've already emphasized, that this is the place where so many people were killed. Interestingly though, this is also the place where the Holocaust happened. So another way of thinking about what I've just said is that in addition to the 5.5 million Jews who were deliberately murdered in an unprecedented campaign to exterminate an entire nation defined racially, in addition to those 5.5 million Jews who were murdered, around 8 million other people were murdered in the same place and at roughly the same time between 1933 and 1945. Once you notice that, you might begin to ask yourself, do the events have something to do with each other? That is to say, does the murder of 5.5 million Jews have something in common with, say, the deliberate starvation of Soviet Ukraine? Does it have something in common with the other campaigns of mass murder that happened in these places? And I think rather intuitively, our intuition anyway, ought to be yes, right? If you walked into a house, if you forgive the clumsy analogy, if you were a paramedic or a policeman, and you walked into a house, and you saw that there were 14 people who were dead there, five of them seemed to belong to one family. The others didn't seem to belong to the same family, but they were all in the same house, and you found them at the same time. You would probably think, these murders probably have something to do with each other, right? Wouldn't you? You would at least, that would be your starting hypothesis. And it's interesting that for us, it's not. The next thing which is interesting about this place is that this is the place where both German and Soviet power were present, right? So there are many places where Nazi power was present, but Soviet power never was, like occupied France, the Low Countries, most of Germany itself. There are many places where Soviet power was present, but German power never reached, right? Most of the Soviet Union, the vast majority, in fact, of the Soviet Union. What we're concerned with here today are the places which were touched by both German and Soviet power between 1933 and 1945. And again, the striking thing is that all three of these definitions of the Bloodlands, where the Germans and the Soviets both were, where the Holocaust took place, and where 14 million people were killed, all three of these definitions give you exactly the same map. They give you exactly the same place. And that's the observation from which my book begins. Now, this, I take it, is a very simple observation. Everything I've said so far has proceeded from really, I think, straightforward geographical observations. I've had to do a little addition, but that's really it. Admittedly, I mean, for us in the 21st century in the Western world, geography and arithmetic are, you know, often not our best subjects. But really, everything I've said so far is just, it really is just geography and arithmetic. There's nothing particularly controversial about any of it. The question then arises, I think, why haven't we seen it this way, or why do we not see it this way? If this was, as I'm claiming, the greatest moral and demographic catastrophe in the history of the West, why has it not been seen as such? And I think we know the answer. The answer is, we do have stories, we do have histories about parts of this event, right? We have histories of Ukrainian suffering, or Polish suffering, Lithuanian suffering, Russian suffering. We have histories of national suffering. We have histories of Soviet terror. We have histories of the Soviet Union in the 1930s. And we have histories of the Holocaust. In fact, we have an incredibly sophisticated and broad history of the Holocaust. What we don't see, and the observation from which this book begins, is that these three literatures, these three stories, are all really describing the same place. They're describing the same place. Even though you can read an awful lot in all of them without realizing that, right? You can be an expert in one or the other or the third without realizing that the territory that you're reading about is the same territory which figures in these other literatures. And there's a reason for that, of course. And the reason for that is that we tend to think in national terms. Our history is written in national terms, it's read in national terms, it's closely bound in with our national identity. But there's another problem, I think. The other problem is perhaps even deeper. It has to do with the way we think about politics, or the way we think about ideology. Ever since the French Revolution, and I think especially since the ideological clashes of the 1930s, which are still with us, we tend to think of politics in terms of right and left. And we really think right is over here and left is, oh, sorry, right is over here. It was your right, so right is over here, left is over here. So the Soviet Union is in one place, Nazi Germany is another place. If you read the literatures about these two states, you realize they don't usually refer to each other very much. It's as though they happened on different planets. And of course, the ideologies are very different, and the systems were also quite different. But what the two systems have in common, and again, this is not very controversial, it's just a simple fact, what the two systems have in common is territory, right? They're different systems, different visions of the future, different ideologies, but what they have in common is territory. They touch the same peoples. They touch the same lands, and that's my subject. So, how might we try to write this history of this larger catastrophe in a way which might avoid some of these problems? In the book, I follow a few methods which I hope will seem just as conservative and straightforward as the reasoning so far has been. The first thing that I try very hard to do in this book is to avoid national exceptionalism. That is to say, I do not start the book from the observation that such and such number of Jews died, such and such number of Ukrainians died, such and such number of Poles or Russians. I know what those numbers are, more or less, and I know that the fates of people were different depending upon who they were, or rather, who they were seen to be. But if you start a history from an observation that 14 million human beings died, you end up seeing a very different picture than if you start from an observation that such and such number of Jews died, or Poles died, or Ukrainians died. And it's an important difference because the way that you write from national history can give you the right questions, but it can't answer them, right? So the Holocaust is an event that you can describe within Jewish history, right? Indeed, you would have to, but you can't explain it from within Jewish history, because the forces at work simply go beyond the Jewish nation, not only into other nations, but into a realm of forces which are more powerful than a nation, right? Which is the mistake that we always make, I think. We like to think that we can understand our own nation's history in our own nation's terms. I mean, this is something that American historians could hardly be worse about than they are. We all commit this biographical fallacy. We think that the things that we experience in our own terms actually explain why we are where we are. And of course that's not true. It's not true of us and it's not true of the nations. To put it in a different way, the questions that national history asks, and they're good questions morally, good questions politically, are things like, why were we the victims? Or, why were we the perpetrators? Or, perhaps the most relevant question of all, why did we do nothing, right? These important we questions, important for moral inquiry, important for identity. But it cannot answer those questions. It asks them, it forces us to consider them as it should, but it cannot answer them. What I was trying to do is answer these questions. The second thing that I do in this book, which is a bit different, is that I try very hard to avoid dialectics. What do I mean by dialectics? Well, one form of dialectics is the Soviet version, the kind that Stalin practiced and that Molotov and Kaganovich practiced all the way through their long lives. Namely, sure, they would concede, okay, they wouldn't say sure, but they would concede that in the 1930s, policies of repression killed a very large number of people. But they would continue. The Red Army won the Second World War. And of course, it's not just Stalin and the Politburo of the 1930s who reasoned like that. There are many, 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 many other people who reasoned like that in the 20th century. And there are still very many people, and I hear from them from time to time, who reason like that today. There's a problem with this, and it's not just the factual problem. The factual problem, of course, is that the terror and the famine of the 1930s didn't actually help the Red Army. That's the factual problem, but there's a deeper problem. There's a deeper historical, methodological problem, and that's this. If you want to explain, for example, why there was a famine in Soviet Ukraine in 1933, you can't refer forwards to 1945, right? That's a historical no-no. You can't do it any more than I can explain my lecture here in 2012 by things that are going to happen in 2025, right? I can say in 2025, oh, it all made sense somehow, but I can't explain why I'm here by referring to 2025. You can't explain 1933 by referring to 1945 either. The other kind of dialectic, which I'm trying to avoid, is one which is rather popular in Europe, especially in Western Europe, I think. And that is the idea that the two systems, because they were opposites somehow, canceled each other out, right? This is a way of thinking about the two systems in purely ideological terms, rather than political terms or social terms, and imagining that they were simply the opposite of each other. Now, they were different, of course, but they weren't in any philosophical sense the opposite of one another. When the two of them met, as they did, they didn't cancel each other out. They accumulated, right? The encounter of Soviet Union and Nazi Germany, whether it's an encounter of plans of conquest, whether it's in a military alliance, as in 1931, whether it's war in 1941, these are not philosophical encounters. These are practical, social, territorial encounters. And when one examines this in historical terms, you don't, of course, see the two of them cancel each other out. You see that the two of them add to each other, right? To put it in the simplest possible way, it's bad to be occupied. But it's not better to be doubly occupied, right? The second occupation doesn't cancel out the first one. It simply accumulates. And the third one, when it comes, makes things worse yet indeed. So, and there is, of course, a band of territory within what I'm calling the Bloodlands, which was triply occupied, as most of you will know. First the Soviets, then the Germans, then the Soviets a third time. And not surprisingly, it's that band of territory which was the deadliest place to live in all of Europe during the Second World War. By the way, regardless of who you were, it was the worst place to be. The other thing which I do, which is different from previous treatments, is that I'm focusing quite carefully on policies of deliberate murder. In other words, my subject is death. My subject is political killing, political mass killing. Why is that different? It's different because, in general, when we consider one of these systems or both of these systems, and we consider their policies of oppression, we think about the camps. The camps are the dominant symbol both of Nazi and of Soviet oppression, right? The gulag on the Soviet side, the concentration camps on the German side. I was struck a few years ago when I watched a German movie called Der Untergang, Downfall, which was about Hitler's last weeks in the bunker. Good film. But at the end they had, you know, as a proper German pedagogical tool, at the end they had a shot of a message, a poster, which tells you what you needed to know. It says, in case you didn't know, there was the Holocaust. That's what it says. But the way what it actually said was something like, Germans murdered 6 million Jews in concentration camps during the Second World War, which is not actually true. I mean, the 6 million part and the murdered part and the Germans part, that's all fine. But concentration camps had almost nothing to do with it. They had relatively little to do with it. The vast majority of Jews who were killed in the Holocaust never saw a camp. The ones who went through camps had some chance of surviving, some chance of writing their memoirs later on, some chance of speaking to us later on, and therefore their path, which was really an exceptional one, has become the canonical one. And this is true of everyone I'm talking about. Just as Jews who died in the Holocaust were shot very close to where they lived, or gassed, usually not very far from where they lived, the people who were starved or shot in these other campaigns of murder, also, they generally didn't see concentration camps. They were starved or they were shot very close to where they lived. That's my subject here. These 14 million people, for the most part, didn't see concentration camps. And that gives you, by the way, a different geography of the event, right? Solzhenitsyn speaks of the Gulag Archipelago. And the camps, the Soviet camps, were, of course, all across Siberia into Kazakhstan. The German concentration camps were started out in Germany. But the murder actually takes place in this terrain which is in a way shielded by the concentration camps. It takes place in this terrain between Moscow and Berlin, in these lands that I'm calling the Bloodlands. The final thing that I'm doing, as you've already gathered, is that I'm concentrating hard on territory. The observation begins from territory, and the method of the book is to pay attention to territory all the way through, to watch who lives there, everyone who lives there, right, and to see how they die if they die. And this allows me to avoid noticing national differences except when they become important, as they do. It also allows me to see the two regimes in a slightly different way. Usually when there are books about these killings, they're about either the Nazis or the Soviets. I've already explained why I think it has to be about both. When there are books that are about both, they suffer from what I call, probably because of my lifestyle, the jet lag problem, which is that you read one chapter and it's about Berlin, and the chapter ends, and you read another chapter and it's about Moscow, and that ends, and you go back to Berlin. Right? And that's a very effective way of narrating. You know, everyone who writes books knows that when you don't have a segue, you end the chapter, and you start another chapter. And that's the way these comparative biographies of Hitler and Stalin work, right? I don't think that's fully adequate. The way that I write means that by focusing on territory, I'm seeing the two regimes as they are active on the territory. So I'm seeing the Einsatzgruppen, or I'm seeing the Communist Party, or the NKVD, and I'm following what they're doing to human beings. But I'm also then following the chain of command back to Moscow. So Moscow and Berlin, Hitler and Stalin certainly figure very large. They loom very large in the book. But especially as their policies, their institutions are acting upon a certain territory, which you've already seen is the crucial territory. So if you start from territory, What are you then able to argue? What kind of case can you build? What kind of explanation can you offer? Let me try to bridge the gap in the next few minutes between territory and ideology, right? We generally probably think, all of us, that ideology is important to all of us, and it is. Ideology is crucially important. The question, I think, which I'm going to try to answer in a very schematic way, and we can talk about it later, the question is, how do you link these ideologies, the two of them, to the territory, to the people who were killed? I'm just going to suggest a few steps. One thing that you have to be able to do is to see how the ideology is incorporated by political institutions, how it becomes the ideology of states. Because ideologies themselves don't kill people, right? They don't walk down the street and kill people. I mean, despite what everyone says in my country on talk radio, Marxism doesn't just knock on your door and kill you. Marxism, in the Soviet case, is incorporated by a Leninist party with a very special understanding of Marxism, and then in Stalinist state institutions, etc. Anti-Semitism. There's a very broad history of anti-Semitism. So long as there's a history of Eastern Europe, there's a history of anti-Judaic feeling in the modern period, what we would call anti-Semitism. That anti-Semitism, however, brings about relatively little death. The Holocaust is an event of an entirely different scale compared to anything which had happened to Jews in Eastern Europe before. So you cannot explain the mass killing by reference just to anti-Semitism. You have to have an account of how anti-Semitism becomes a state ideology of an important state, namely Nazi Germany. And then you have to watch, and that's not enough, by the way, because Nazi Germany doesn't kill that many Jews between 1933 and 1939, a few hundred. You have to watch that anti-Semitic state make colonial war against its eastern neighbors, against the places where Jews actually lived in large numbers. You need all of that. So you have to be able to see how ideology penetrates institutions, which historians of Germany and the Soviet Union should be said have done a very good job with. This is also an important point for the vexing and troubling question of collaboration. In order to understand collaboration, which we have to do because most of these policies involve collaboration in one way or another, we have to understand what the institutions are and what their ideologies are. Collaboration is not really a phenomenon so much from below. Right? When it's nice to see students here, when students applied to this university and had to write an essay about what they were going to do after they finished, none of them said, when I'm a proud holder of a bachelor's degree from the University of Manitoba, I want to grow up and be a collaborator. Right? It's not a vocation. Right? It's not a life path that one plans for oneself. People do collaborate for various reasons, which we can talk about. But in order to understand collaboration, one has to first see the arrival of a foreign institution and understand what kind of ideology is behind. The second thing that I think we have to do to connect territory and ideology is to see that ideology always has an economic component. I don't mean, you know, the way that the Marxist might mean that you can simply deduce what someone thinks from their social position. But what I mean in particular is that Soviet and Nazi ideology, which we tend to think of just in terms of ideas, we can think of them very abstractly, both had visions of the economic transformation of the world. And that these visions of economic transformation are really inherent close part of the killing policies that then followed. So of course, the Nazi vision is one of racial struggle, it's one of racial war, it's one of racial superiority of Germans. But there's a particular racial war which is more important than racial war in the abstract, and that is the struggle for Lebensraum in Eastern Europe. The redemption of the German soul by conquering an Eastern colony, the driving out of the Slavic Menschen, the elimination of the Jews in Eastern Europe. Not just because Eastern Europe is there, but because the economic idea is that Germany is already a modern industrial country, which should also become an empire. Remember, this is a world of imperialism. Great Britain is the great power in the world. What the Germans, and by the way, the Soviets also think this, if you want to become an empire, a powerful state in the first part of the 20th century, you have to set up your own empire. And there's only one place to do it, and that place is Eurasia. The world is closed off to you by the British fleet. Right? I realize that as soon as I say British fleet, I look like I'm 80 years old, but the British fleet was, from the point of view of both Berlin and Moscow, the dominant structural feature of the whole world. Right? They saw it differently. Hitler saw the British fleet as an emanation of Jewish-British finance capital. Stalin saw the British fleet as an emanation of the world capitalist imperialist conspiracy, right? But they both saw the British as the one superpower, and the British fleet is structuring the world order. Therefore, if you want to change the world in your favor, you have to do so in Eurasia. The German vision was, you first conquer an eastern colony, and then you use that agrarian colony to balance the modernity you already have. The Soviet vision was in a way the opposite. The Soviet vision was, we are not a modern country, we are a backward country. Our job is to become a modern country, to catch up to the capitalists. And the way that we're going to do that is by exploiting the places within the Soviet Union that do have fertile soil, exploit an agricultural surplus to build up the cities, to build up the factories. Right? Now, the interesting thing about that is that one of the places, and probably the most important place, which is has fertile soil and has agricultural surpluses, is Ukraine. So when you think through these two ideologies down to their practical economic conclusions, you find yourself arriving at the same place, you see, at the exact same place. The Germans and the Soviets have different ideas about what they're going to do with Ukraine, but that they need Ukraine, that they have in common. Now, if you've come with me this far, then I think, in some sense, the argument of the book, or this terrible catastrophe which is the subject of the book, become easier to understand, become easier to explain. You can see certain general things, so to speak, that are likely to happen in the 30s and 40s. You can see where the Soviets and the Germans can agree. Where can they agree? They can agree with respect to a place which I don't think I've mentioned, which is independent Poland. From the point of view of either of these visions, whether what you need in Eastern Europe is an agrarian colony, or whether what you need in Eastern Europe is a source of modernization, Nazi vision, Soviet vision, in both visions, Poland is simply in the way. Poland is in the way. Poland is awkward. Poland is the only significant political entity between these two countries. And in practice, this is where they do agree, as you will all know. In 1939, Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union strike a military alliance and jointly invade Poland, and indeed do remove the state of Poland from the map, with disastrous consequences, I think. Not just for Poles. Indeed, I would say not even mainly for Poles, but I'll return to that. You can also see where they cannot agree, where they must fight. Where they must fight is over Ukraine. If Ukraine is the source of the magical economy that's going to allow the Nazis and the Soviets in their different ways to break the old rules, to rush forward into a new kind of modernity, become great powers, to rival the British and the Americans and so on, they have to have it. And when they do fight, it is indeed over Ukraine, chiefly over Ukraine. Also the oil in the Caucasus, but chiefly over Ukraine. And you can perceive also, if a little bit more hazily, the outlines of the event that we're going to come to call the Holocaust. Because this territory that I'm talking about, between Berlin and Moscow, that is the world homeland of the Jews. From the point of view of 1933, or 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, this is the world homeland of the Jews. In a purely demographic sense, I'm not trying to make a political statement here, this is where most Jews live. So if there is going to be a clash or an interaction of these two powers over this territory, the Jews are bound to suffer from it. And given that the Germans or the Nazis, that the central feature of their own ideology is that every woe that befalls the German nation is the fault of the Jews, then you can expect that what's going to happen to the Jews after the Germans move east is going to be particularly disastrous, right? It's going to be the thing that we know is going to happen. Now, you can go that far, I think, by way of a general structural explanation. The way the book operates is that it tries to describe and explain each of the particular killing policies, which, when you take them together, gives you this general catastrophe and this number 14 million. Because everything that I've said so far, it's a kind of general structure, right? It's a kind of form. It makes it not surprising the things that happen, but the things happen the way they happen because of particular political decisions made by particular people at particular times. They might have gone otherwise. And so we have to break down this larger explanation and consider particular policies, which is what the book does. Chapter 1 considers the deliberate Soviet starvation of Ukraine. We now know that Stalin identified for his own purposes the failure of collectivization in Ukraine as a political crisis. With particular actors who were to be held responsible. Among them was the Ukrainian nation. We also know that in the autumn of 1932, The Politburo ordered a series of particular policies, I can go into more detail if you want later, but a series of particular policies which they knew would cause starvation in Ukraine, much more starvation than need have happened simply from collectivization. The second and third chapters of the book treat the Great Terror in the Soviet Union, which took about 700,000 lives, 700,000 Soviet citizens individually shot in the back of the neck. The largest action of the Great Terror we now know was the Kulak action. A kulak is, of course, as you will know, many of you, a politically suspect peasant. Right? How do you become a politically suspect peasant? You are deported to the gulag during collectivization. You have a five-year term. You come back alive. That makes you politically suspect because it's quite possible that after that experience, you won't support the regime. And that's how Stalin reasoned in 1936, 37, and 38. Many of the people who were deported to the gulag during collectivization came back and then were taken out and shot. The largest action, the Great Terror, the Kulak action, took about 400,000 lives. The next largest group of actions, and this has been kind of a surprise, and it's something which hasn't really penetrated the historiography yet, were the national actions. About 250,000 Soviet citizens were shot on ethnic grounds in 1937. In 1938. They all belonged to national groups which could be seen as having connections to the Soviet Union's neighbors. So for example, the largest operation, Operation 00485, the Polish operation, was directed against ethnic Poles in the Soviet Union because they could be seen, they didn't usually, but they could be seen as having connections with Poland, with the Soviet Union's neighbor Poland. All of the Koreans, every last one in the Soviet Union, were deported to Central Asia because Korea was then occupied by Japan, and so Koreans might be Japanese spies. So every last one of them was deported. These two events together basically make up the Great Terror. When we think of the Great Terror, we often think of purges of officers, which happened. We often think of the show trials, which happened. But the show trials are really just the tip of the iceberg. The show trials are remembered because they were public, and what I'm talking about was secret. They're remembered because the people in question were often sympathetic intellectuals, you know, people wearing glasses with whom we could identify, wearing contacts. But that was really, that's just the very tip of what the Great Terror actually was. The Great Terror was really about the murder of workers and peasants, the groups that the Soviet Union was supposed to be supporting. Chapter 4 is a crucial chapter because Chapter 4 describes the encounter of Soviet and German power, the direct encounter in 1939. By way of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, so the de facto military alliance between the two states. This is important, not so much because it's surprising, I don't find it particularly surprising. It's important because of what it allows to happen. Most obviously, it allows Soviet policies of oppression to move west. As the Soviet Union moves west, after the annexation of the Baltics, after the annexation of Eastern Poland, Soviet policies of oppression are applied in these new annexed Soviet territories. Just to give you a striking example, the NKVD, the Soviet secret police, state police, makes more arrests in annexed Eastern Poland, right, than it does in the rest of the Soviet Union in 1940. Right? So in places that we know under names like Galicia, Volhynia, right, Western Belarus, the NKVD makes more arrests in 1940 than it does in the entire rest of the country, which is really extraordinary. But there's something I think even more important than this. And that is that 1939 is when German policies of mass killing get underway. Hitler is in power from 1933 to 1939. And Germany is quite significantly changed during this period. But it does not undertake any policies of mass killing until 1939. And when it does, these are almost entirely across the Polish border. The Einsatzgruppen begin to kill in large numbers when they kill educated Poles in the fall and winter of 1939, and so on. So this changes the relationship between Nazi Germany and the people it rules quite dramatically. And then there's something which I think is more important still, and on which I'm going to lay a certain emphasis because it often gets overlooked. 1939 means the destruction of states. The destruction of states. Now, I understand that from a certain, you know, West Ukrainian nationalist perspective, you could say, oh, that might be a good thing, right? It didn't turn out to be such a good thing. It didn't turn out to be such a good thing for the people involved. Let me try to explain why. In general, when we consider history, we think about states. The odd thing, though, is that in 1939, we very often adapt the perspective of the Soviets and the Nazis, who come into Poland And they see not a Polish state, but they see ethnicities, right? The Soviets claim they're liberating their Ukrainian and Belarusian brethren, etc. And the Germans come in thinking we're going to reorder the Untermenschen, we're going to put the Poles and the Jews they belong, right? They see it ethnically. And we very often do too. We don't stop and ask ourselves, why does it matter that the Polish state was destroyed? Or the Lithuanian state, or the Estonian state, or the Latvian state? One doesn't have to have a great deal of sympathy for these states. They weren't wonderful states. But the difference between a state, the rule of law, and statelessness is really quite extraordinary, and is extraordinarily bad, especially for national minorities. So usually if anybody writes, for example, about the destruction of the Lithuanian state, or the destruction of the Polish state, that would be Lithuanian historians, or Polish historians. But what I'd like to submit to you is the destruction of states was actually worse for national minorities than anyone else, and in particular, for Jews, which we always overlook. Histories of the Holocaust never stop on this fact, but let me just make an observation. If you took the whole history of the Holocaust, imagine just for a moment yourself from the point of view of the Jews of Europe in, say, 1941 or 42. If you lived in a place if you lived in a state, an existing state, an undestroyed state, that was an ally of Nazi Germany, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, Italy, your chances of survival as a Jew would be 1 in 2, which is horrible. It's worse than anyone else's. If you lived in Nazi Germany as a Jew, your chance of survival was about 1 in 2. If you lived in the places that I'm talking about, where the state was destroyed, Poland, the Baltics, later on the Western Soviet Union, your chances of surviving were 1 in 20. You had a 95% chance of dying. So within this catastrophe of the Holocaust, it seems to make a great deal of difference whether the state was destroyed or not. Which is why I think 1939 is not just some funny asterisk about a Soviet-German alliance, which seems strange to us. It's not even just about the Soviets and the Germans oppressing populations. It's about the beginning of a larger process of state destruction, which turns out, I think, to be quite fatal for everyone. The way that it's fatal is something that I describe in Chapter 5. Chapter 5 considers the relationship between what the Germans thought they were going to do in June of 1941 when they invade the Soviet Union, when they betray their ally and invade the Soviet Union, and what they in fact do thereafter. To make a long story more or less short, what they think they're going to do is destroy the Soviet state in 2 months, 3 months at the outside. Having destroyed the Soviet state, they were going to starve about 30 million people to death in the first winter after the war, so in their minds the winter of 1941-42. Then they were undertake long-term plans for colonization, which would involve the further starvation, deportation, and literal enslavement of tens of millions of more people. They were going to destroy most of the larger Soviet cities, build up their own new towns with Germans, with quite literally Slavic slaves inhabiting the suburbs, the people who were left. And along the way, but after the war, they were going to drive the Jews of Eastern Europe east across the Ural Mountains, where presumably they would perish. What the Germans in fact do is something quite different. They scale back most of these policies. They can't really colonize, although of course there are some terrible examples of their trying, like for example around Zamość. And they can't starve on a huge scale. It's very difficult to starve people to death. It requires a huge amount of control. What happened in Ukraine in 1933 is actually quite exceptional. But more than that, because the war lasted longer than the Germans thought, they couldn't really expect all of the non-Germans behind the lines to starve themselves to death. They needed these people to be more or less going along with occupation, and they needed these people to feed their soldiers. Because remember, this is kind of the key to the whole century, Germany is not self-sufficient in food. And as Germany fights a war on the Eastern Front, it can't be the German people back home who suffer, right? It has to be somebody else. So the Germans need the Lithuanians and the Ukrainians and the Belarusians and all the others to grow food for them. And you can't starve everyone if you want them to grow food. So they do starve. They starve and besiege Leningrad. They starve to a lesser extent in Kharkiv and Kiev. They do starve above all in the prisoner of war camps where they put Soviets. This is the second largest German war crime, and it's very often forgotten. They starved to death something like 3.1 million Soviet citizens in these starvation facilities. But these are all scaling down from the original intentions. The one place where the Germans scale up as in the final solution. They had been considering the final solution of what they thought was the Jewish problem as some kind of violent deportation of the Jews after a victorious war. What happens instead is that as the war goes on longer than they expect, they escalate their policies towards the Jews, shooting Jewish males as they invade the Soviet Union, then shooting Jewish women and children in the summer of autumn of 1941, then destroying whole communities by gunfire in August, September, October, November, December of 1941, to the point that by the end of 1941, something like a million Jews have been killed in the occupied Soviet Union, almost all of them by shooting. And that version of what we now call the Holocaust will continue. About half the Jewish victims of the Holocaust will be shot. In 1942, the main technology, though, will shift to the one which is more familiar to us, which is gassing in occupied Poland. So in the next several chapters of the book, I consider the progress of the Holocaust from Lithuania to Ukraine to Belarus back to Poland. I then have a chapter about the Warsaw Uprising, which is a signal case of the third largest German policy of mass killing after the Holocaust, after the prisoners of war, which is reprisals against civilians, so-called reprisals. These are actually most dramatic in Belarus, where some 300,000 Belarusians are killed in reprisal actions. That these are not reprisals is very clear by the end, where the Germans are just gathering Belarusian men for labor and shooting women and children and then burning the villages. But the Warsaw Uprising is also a very dramatic example. During the Warsaw Uprising, the Germans shoot about at least 120,000 Polish civilians in actions that have nothing to do with combat. It seems that they stop because they're short on ammunition. But that is one large episode of this larger policy of reprisals in which roughly 750,000 to a million people are killed. I then close the book with a chapter on ethnic cleansing at the end of the war, which is not exactly my subject, but which I need to get us from the world of mass killing to the world of the Cold War. And then finally with a reflection on why Stalin became anti-Semitic at the end of his life, which strikes me as an important thing to understand if you want to understand why the relationship between all these crimes has been so difficult for everyone since then. All right, so that's the way the book works. Let me just leave you with three thoughts about what the book is intending to do and what it's not intending to do. The first thing that I want to stress is that although I don't have any problem with comparisons, and I'm happy to make them if you like, this book is not really a comparison. One very strong impulse when considering the subject is to say, well, who was worse, Hitler or Stalin? Again, I have views about that. Or who was worse, Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union? I have views about that. But that's not really what the book is about. To compare two people or two things, you have to say, I know everything there is to know about them, and now I'm going to hold them apart. I'm going to say they're analytically separate. One's here, I'm going to compare them. Right? I'm standing up, you're sitting down, I'm talking, you're not talking, and so on. That's a comparison. The way this book works is different. The book does not start from the assumption that we know everything we need to know. On the contrary, I think we don't know many of the things we need to know, because if we don't understand the 14 million, then we haven't understood the systems. And until we understand the systems, we can't go on to compare them. So I'm trying to understand the murder of 14 million. But the other thing which is relevant here is that rather than being a comparison, this is a story of interaction, right? So to go back to what I said a moment ago, I'm going to stop talking in about 4 minutes and 25 seconds. At that point, you will ask me questions. We'll both be talking. There will be an interaction, right? It will no longer be possible to separate us in the same way. That's more what my book is like, right? It's much more about an interaction than it is about a comparison. It's about the presence of both of these systems in the same place. Now, that allows us, I think, to make some interesting comparative judgments if we want to. And the second thing I wanted to say by way of conclusion is that I think it's perfectly fine to compare. I think it's fine. It's not really my object here. But I think it's the kind of thing which intellectually we have to commit ourselves to do, because if we don't, the history of the time and place is going to be totally impossible, right? If I say, for example, the Soviets had a policy of deliberate starvation in 1933, which killed about 3.3 million people, and I say the Germans had a policy of deliberate starvation in 1941 and 1942, which killed about 4 million people, I've just made a comparison, and you have too, right? You haven't stopped yourself, right? How could you stop yourself? Especially given that this comparison is not something which you and I are doing. This comparison is something which exists in the minds and the memories of the people who lived through these things. Just to take that example, as many of you will know, there were Ukrainians who survived 1933, only to die of starvation in German prisoner of war camps in 1941. And there were Ukrainians who survived first the one and the other, and then talked about it, and then wrote about it. Those of you who are familiar with Holodomor materials will know that if you ask Ukrainians about starvation, very often they will speak not only of 1933, but then they'll speak about 1941. Right? That comparison is just there in their experience. Or to turn the matter around in a different way. One of the ways to do research on the Holodomor is to watch or read Jewish testimonial materials. Because if you ask Jews who were born in the 1910s or the 1920s in Ukraine to tell the story of their lives, very often the first thing they mention is the Holodomor, because that was the first serious damaging experience of their lives. At USC, where Steven Spielberg is collecting these video testimonial materials, there's an entire side project which is devoted to the Holodomor on the basis of Jewish testimonial evidence. Because, you know, they didn't know this in advance, but because so many of the Jews talked about it, right? Unasked, I should say, talked about it. So the point is that the comparison is not something which you're doing or which I'm doing. The comparison is something which is deep in the experience, and it has to be. Just to give you one more thought, consider a poll in Warsaw, or it could be a Jew or a Ukrainian for that matter, in Warsaw in 1939, in September. The Red Army is coming from one side, the Wehrmacht is coming from the other. Those people are comparing. They're trying to decide what to do, which way to run, or to run at all. That's a comparative judgment. The people in this part of the world were condemned to compare. We have been able, if we want to, from the luxury of distance and the luxury of time, to separate these stories out. But for the people who experienced them, they were experienced very often together. And the point of that, by the way, is not that everyone loved their neighbor, right, as perhaps they ought to have done. But they knew what befell their neighbor, and they very often wrote about it. And that connectedness of the history is something which resides, and sorry if I'm belaboring the point, but it resides in the primary source materials themselves. The final thing I want to say about comparison is this. If I were to say to you, Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union are incomparable, what have I really said? Okay, I didn't do it in the 4 minutes, did I? All right. They're incomparable. What have I really said? I have said, I have compared them. You should not compare them. And I have the microphone. That's all I have said. The judgment incomparable assumes a prior comparison. If somebody says X and Y are incomparable, all that means is they've already compared them. And they don't want you to. So it's a power claim. It's a very effective power claim. And I'm not saying I can stop people from making that power claim. I just want to call it what it is. It's a power claim. It's not logical. Historical scholarship can't endure it. Can't survive it, I don't think. Now I'm aware that where this power claim comes from is sometimes a real moral concern. And the moral concern is that if you compare things, if you allow things to join each other in one history, you will somehow be diminishing them. And I think, and I spend a lot of time on this in the book, but I think that it's exactly the opposite. I think if we want to know the specific character of events, we have to see how they're different from other events. Right? And the only way to see how they're different from other events is to have all those events in the same book. Further, if we want to entrench events that we think are important in history, it's important to have them in history. If you pull them out of history with the hope of protecting them, if you put them behind the plexiglass of commemoration, they no longer make sense. And not only do they no longer make sense, the rest of the story no longer makes sense, because you've pulled this out of it. So, in other words, I think that bad history is bad for us. I warned you this is going to be very conservative. I think bad history is bad for us. And I think good history, investigative history, taboo-free history, history which is neither provocative nor respectful of taboos, it's good for us. All right. So I've let you know what I think about the subject of the book, the method of the book, the interpretation of the book, the subject of the book. But as I close, and now I really am closing, I will fulfill the promise. I want to make clear that at the center of the book, not so much of the lecture, because of the nature of the difference between talking and writing, but at the center of the book is the subject, this 14 million. And I want to say a word about that. we have to try to explain the 14 million. We have to try to be precise about the 14 million and about the smaller numbers that make it up. But the most important smaller number that makes up the 14 million is the number one. 14 million means 14 million times one, where the one is not just some generic unit, one life, where the one is an irreplaceable, unique, individual human life, different from the one before, different than the one after. In other words, I think history is about life. It's about individual human life. It's not about mass death, which means that this book is at the very edge of what history can actually do. And the justification for this book, if there can be justification for a book like this, is that it's always working against the big numbers. It's recognizing them as giving their due, but in some sense it's working against them. Or to put it a different way, in many ways, Stalin and Hitler still rule our minds intellectually, I'm afraid. And one of these ways is that these numbers are so big that they become abstractions. We can't really think with numbers like 3 million or 6 million or 14 million. These regimes turned people into numbers, and it's the numbers that we have all too often rather than the people. So ultimately what I think one has to be doing in writing about subjects like this, if one is going to be a historian or a humanist, is one has to try to take these numbers and turn them back into people. And that's what the book undertakes to do. So the very last thing I want to do is give you the names of the three people I mentioned at the beginning. Because, of course, all 14 million of the people who are our subject had names. The young man in Soviet Ukraine, his name was Petro Veldy. The Polish officer's name was Adam Solsky. And the young Jewish woman in Kowel, her name was Dobcha Kagan. Thank you very much.
Archives and Special Collections, on behalf of my colleagues on the Rudnyckyj Committee, the University of Manitoba Archives and Special Collections, the Slavic Collection of the Elizabeth Defoe Library, and German and Slavic Studies, and a special thank you to the Consulate General of the Republic of Poland in Toronto and the Canadian Polish Congress of Manitoba Branch, without whom we would absolutely not have been able to bring a speaker in the same year that we brought in another Rudnyckyj speaker. So I want to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Snyder for, I think, giving us a completely different vision of a time period of which I'm sure all of us had been instructed in school. We got obviously a much narrower and I would say not a very truthful look at that time period. And so this sort of redresses the balance. Thank you. And you said that you could take some
questions. So now's the interaction part. I mean, where it's been more than 4 minutes and 25 seconds.
Okay.
If you can please tell me who you are, if you could please ask your questions in the form of a question.
Rather than a question, can I just make a brief comment?
I can't stop you.
You know who I am, Martin Zielik. Your wonderful comment at the end about naming these people, because that's what we need to do. Just to make a point that there's an exhibition currently in Winnipeg called Names Instead of Numbers at Westminster United Church. And I've seen it, and I encourage anyone here who's interested to go see it. It's about the prisoners who are at Dachau concentration camp. So just a way to illustrate that wonderful comment you made.
Hello, thank you. I like the ending you had to take something out of context and present it in a way that it's bad history. Over the years, so many of us in the diaspora have lived with people being charged and tried in today's standards what happened in this horrible period. And what comes to mind is the recent death of John Deniniuk, a man who was a Soviet soldier in a prisoner of war camp and was tried in a German court where his superiors could not be tried. The Germans were never tried. And as he said, the only reason I'm here is because the Germans invaded Ukraine. So the point is, how do you take a look at something and what's your opinion of trying to apply today's principles of law, justice, humanity, to what happened at what you describe, they ran out of bullets before they could kill all the people of Warsaw. So, briefly, those are my comments.
Sorry, what was your name?
John.
Thank you. So, I understand what you're meaning, where you're coming from, I believe, but I wouldn't come down so hard against today's standards of law. On the contrary, I think one of the relatively few valuable concepts that we've gotten out of the 1930s and 40s, as we've reinterpreted them, is the notion of human rights, it's a much more important idea now in the world. It wasn't a concept which mattered much in the 30s and 40s. So there are certainly ideas, there are ways that we've learned from the period, which I don't think we should toss out. Now your point is, I take it, that one ought not to abstractly apply principles of today without knowledge of the history of the past. And there with Demjanjuk, you have a very important point. I mean, I didn't follow the technicalities of this case closely, I have to confess. But you have a very important point, which is that almost no one who contemplated that case knew anything about the nature of the German camps for Soviet prisoners of war. Almost no one understood that these were starvation facilities. In other words, the kinds of places where if you were there, if the person next to you was there, if I were there, we would have come out if we had been given the opportunity, which is presumably Demjanjuk's story. In other words, there's a part of this story which is pretty essential to the whole life. Of course, you're right, the invasion of the Soviet Union is another part which is essential. But there's a whole major experience there of starvation, of a German war crime, which really doesn't work its way into the narrative. That's true. Now, the question of whether Demjanjuk was guilty or not strikes me as a different question, right? I mean, either he was guilty or he wasn't. And that's a vexed tale. But your point about the partiality of our history making it difficult for us to apply the rule of law, it's a good one.
My name is Vic Coro, the local Renaissance man. When Russia and Germany had a pact, 1931, and then they decided to put the pressure over on Poland and others. What was the logic of Germany then breaking that pact? Is this because if they went so far, they said, okay, we stop here and we're both happy?
Yes, I mean, that would seem to make sense, right? You're bombing Britain. If you're Germany, you need fuel. The Soviets are giving you lots of fuel. You're occupying Western Europe. You need to feed your soldiers. The Soviets are giving you lots of grain. It seems like a very nice arrangement. And Germany, you know, as of that point, hadn't really lost any. It had won its war, you could look at it that way. It defeated the French, who were supposed to have the best army in Europe. Their army was supposed to be better than the Red Army, which is one of the reasons why the Germans thought they could destroy the Soviets so quickly. Now moving towards to the answer to your question. But fundamentally, the answer to your question is a little bit like the answer to another question, which is why didn't Germany use the Ukrainians against the Soviet Union? It has to do with what Hitler's vision of the future was. For Hitler, France, the Low Countries, that was just a distraction, right? The Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact was just a way to buy time. The real goal of his war was to destroy the Soviet Union. And that meant that he had to fight Poland. And fighting Poland brought in the British and the French. And that's we in the West, this is my American or North American we think about the war against the British and against the French as the main thing. But for Hitler, it wasn't. For Hitler, the main thing was, the destruction of the Soviet Union, the occupation of the Western Soviet Union, the creation of a colony, etc., etc., etc. So the paradoxical thing is that the campaigns that you're thinking, that you're proposing Hitler might have been satisfied with, someone else might have been satisfied with them, but not Hitler. Because Hitler's vision of Lebensraum, which was consistent really from beginning to end, always involved this war in the East. That always, there always had to be in the war. That's the war he always wanted, really. So.
Oksana Bashuk-Kepard, I'd like to pick up on the human rights issue and the 14 million killed. And as you may know, in Winnipeg, that particular dimension is being discussed in the context of the Canadian Human Rights Museum. And those of us that would like to see a better representation of the 14 million are up against some of the things that are very difficult to deal with. And that's stacks and stacks of excellent literature about one Holocaust or one crime, and the lack of the kind of wonderful contribution that you have made to history. And on the other hand, it's also very difficult to understand how a historian like you, when you come up against such powerful forces like Steven Spielberg and others, maintain your balance and objectivity. And I wonder if you'd be kind enough to help us out in two ways. First of all, perhaps to indicate how we should stand strong in trying to portray the entire history, and then secondly, how does an academic maintain impartiality? Thank you.
One hates to fight E.T. So with Spielberg, let me say something a little bit different. So I mean, Spielberg made a movie about the Holocaust. And it's a funny movie about the Holocaust because no Jews die in it, right? The Spielberg Hollywoodization of the Holocaust, in my view, actually confirms a story which is not as bad, not nearly as bad, as the actual event was. You know, my view about these things is not at all that one has to reduce the significance of the Holocaust and then balance it with it. My view of these things is that the Holocaust is much worse than most people think it was, in many respects. And that there were other German crimes, of which we generally haven't even heard, which are also quite terrible, like the starvation of Soviet prisoners of war, going back to that question. And that, in addition to that, there are also Soviet crimes, which are less well known, and strangely are ever less known as time went by. That's the odd thing for me. I guess I was of the last Cold War generation, so I took for granted that there were these Soviet crimes. And it's interesting how that knowledge has actually fled us, it's left us in the last 20 years. I don't think that it's a matter of there being a big stack of books here and then you have to, you know, I think it's fine there's a big stack of books about the Holocaust. I wish they were better, honestly, than they are. I wish they were more serious than they are. And, you know, I hope that there will one day be a big stack of books about the starvation of Soviet prisoners of war, and another big, good stack of books about the Holodomor and so on. And I would say that, you know, giving credit where it's due, a book like mine doesn't arise unless you do have lots of often Russian, Ukrainian, Polish historians writing about these events, collecting documents, publishing documents, writing about these events themselves. And one of the things which is different about my book is that it's synthesizing all of this post-Cold War research, which has been done not entirely, but largely by East Europeans in Eastern Europe, using new sources. So you ask how you keep your balance. I mean, the way that I think I've already probably made pretty clear that the method of this book begins from the assumption that individual lives are individual lives. And if we observe a cataclysm in which so many individual lives were lost, then we have an event which we ought to try to explain. That's what I'm trying to do. I have to say I've never felt, you know, buffeted by it at all. Never felt buffeted by, you know, the forces of whatever it might be. Never. I never have. If anything, I've been struck by how, you know, this is going to sound a little pie in the sky, but let me put it a different way. When I finished the book, my view of human nature was rather low. The reception of the book has redeemed my view of human nature to some extent, improved it quite a lot, because in general, people have proven to be much more reasonable than I thought. People have in general proved, and everybody, I mean, I don't mean like Ukrainians have been great, and like the Belarusians have been terrible, or the Jews have been great, and the Poles have been terrible. In general, everyone has been more willing to accept other people into their stories, right? Not necessarily invite them with eagerness, but to accept that they're there in the stories, and that maybe the stories don't even make sense without those other people. So my experience, I mean, I can't really answer your question because I don't really feel knocked around by the reception of this book. Writing the book was a certain kind of challenge, but the reception of it has actually been it's been an extraordinary experience of people being willing to be flexible. Not everybody, mind you, but in general. As to the specific thing you're talking about, you know, no one, I'm aware that there's a museum, right? I'm people, you know, I get petitions from literally all sides, you know, which I'm supposed to sign, but interestingly, no one has ever asked for my advice before. So, you know, but since you ask, I'll tell you what I think. Like, I'm now like blowing the opportunity at consulting fees from the Canadian government. But it seems to me that one way to do it would be that you first ask. This is going to be different from what, you know, everybody's thinking about, by the way. The first thing it seems to me you would do in a museum of human rights is you'd have a pavilion on human rights. Because human rights don't actually, they're not like this thing in nature which just exists. They're a historically constructed and enforced and understood social norm, right? Which largely come out of our subject. I mean, that was, again, my answer to the Nyanya question. But they didn't come from nowhere. I mean, they weren't, you know, there's a view called natural law that God gave them to us, but that's by now a controversial view. They're a historical development, you know. So in my Museum of Human Rights, the first pavilion would be about the history of human rights, right? And it might include references like Raphael Lemkin's definition of genocide, which strikes me as an important turning point. But there's a good history of human rights, and if you don't, you know, this may be my historian's bias, but if you don't see human rights as something with a past, and with a context, and with origins, and so on, then you're not really understanding them, you're just kind of taking them for granted, which is the last thing you'd want to do in a museum, right? Human rights are actually very fragile, historically. The second thing I would do in a museum like this, if I were in Canada, is that I would ask the Canadian question, right? It seems very strange to me that you have a Canadian Museum of Human Rights, or I don't know what it's called, so a Museum of Human Rights in Canada, where the first thing that you ask is not Canada, right? Because human rights are recognized by political institutions. If they're not recognized by political institutions, they don't exist. And the political institution which matters most in Canada is the Canadian federal government. So the first thing you would ask is, what's the history of human rights in Canada? You know, and I don't know anything about that, but it seems that would then involve the First Peoples, and it would involve African Canadians, and the internment of the Japanese during the Second World War on the Canadian West Coast, and things like that, right? That you couldn't really have a Canadian Museum of Human Rights without the history of human rights in Canada, whatever that might be. And then another thing you could do would be that you could have a European pavilion. And, you know, I have a certain view about the history of mass killing in Europe, which I've just shared with you. You could have a European pavilion, which is about the 1930s and 1940s, which starts from the Holodomor and ends with the Holocaust, if you want. And in that way, you could have the totality of the history, and you could point to the relationships in the history, you could point to the similarities, you could also point to the differences. But you would have an important view of the history of Europe. And I would stress the history of Europe. I would think of this as a European pavilion rather than a Holocaust pavilion or a Holodomor pavilion or the H plus H, you know, pavilion. What worries me about the discussion in Canada, insofar as it reaches me, is that it becomes so binary, right? Not just that it's political, you know, and it's like two lobby groups are squaring off. But that leads to a kind of binarism, where it's a zero, you know, the zero-sum game is going to be so much Holocaust and there's going to be so little Holodomor or whatever, you know, so much Holodomor and therefore less Holocaust. I honestly think that's the wrong way to consider it, and I think that's the way it has been considered, at least judging, you know, from the things which reach me. I don't think if you're considering it as a kind of contest between these two things, I think you end up minimizing both of them. And the only way to take them both seriously is to put them both into some kind of larger history. In that larger history, you, of course, would make clear that the Holocaust was the only attempt to exterminate an entire people defined by nationality. I think if you ended with the Holocaust, that would be a nice way of demonstrating that special character of that worst part of this larger catastrophe. But I don't think the way you do this is by putting the Holocaust in one room and then the Holodomor in another room, no matter how big those rooms are, right? I would say, you know, I think that, I mean, for me, you know, I'm imagining what I would do, right? I'm imagining away all the political and financial constraints. But for me, that would be one pavilion. That would be one story. And then you could have a fourth pavilion, which would be something like the world, in which case, where you could have an exhibition on something like, you know, if you wanted to, the spread of democracy, right? If you wanted to tell a slightly happier story about democracy, say, over the course of the 20th century. It could be a truly international exhibition where, you know, you looked at the entire world, because in some sense, you know, Canada, Europe, those are the things which preoccupy us, but human rights by their nature are human, they're therefore global, so the final thing it seems to me would have to be some kind of global pavilion. So, since you ask me, if that's how I would think about it if I were in charge, which I'm not.
We'll take one more question.
Orissa Trotch, I have a question. You spoke about states and then disappearance of states and statelessness. For example, the Polish destruction of the Polish state. I'm a child of two forced laborers from Halicina, from Galicia in Germany. In all the discussions, when you see the documentaries on World War II and the invasion, 39 and all that, Eastern Poland is Halicina, that's Western Ukraine, and somehow the people have been eliminated, exterminated in different ways, but even in history, because de jure, the country did not exist, they don't get the credit for being killed as Ukrainians, and that's not fair in history. You know, the Western Ukraine was ruled by Poland and Belarus, but they were different ethnicities. And as to the colonial thing, my mother remembered black soil in railroad cars being shipped to Germany from Ukraine.
Yeah, so we have to have a way of talking about the world. We have to have ways of talking about the world. So when I say that the Soviet Union invades Eastern Poland, I think that's the only way to talk about it, because you invade sovereign states, you destroy sovereign states. I'm not, when I do that, I'm not giving you my own personal, you know, moral opinion about where Galicia should have been politically, or Volhynia for that matter, or Polesia. But we do have to have a way of telling political history. That isn't, I am not, of course, you know, guilty, I don't think, of the sin of thinking that Galicia, or, you know, Galicia or Galicia or Halicina, or Galician, was inhabited by only one people, right? It was inhabited by a number of peoples, and their history was sometimes, you know, to put it very simply, was sometimes shared, and was sometimes very different. And when somebody in Halicina, to use your term, was killed, let's say they were Ukrainian. A Ukrainian died, but also a Galician died, and also a human being died, right? And we count also a citizen of pre-war Poland died. And we count these things when we're in different ways to paint upon our purposes. But I quite agree with the basic, I think, thrust of your question, which is that we have to count everybody, and we have to know who they were and who they thought they were.
Okay, one more question. Okay, just one more question.
My name is Miroslava. My question is more of a technical nature. You obviously had a lot of research that you conducted in order to gather this information for the book. And by the way, I read it as bedtime reading. It took me, I think, 3 months. But it was extremely interesting. My question is this. Obviously, you had to go into Russian sources as well. How accessible were they to you? I know that Ukrainian SBU archives have been opened up, or they were open until a while ago. I don't know how open they are now. Did you have that same kind of access to Soviet or pre-war Soviet or Russian sources?
So, I'm going to start that question from the other end. There are always sexy stories to tell about that document that you couldn't get to, or that archive that was closed, or the special relationship you had with an archivist.
We won't tell.
Yeah, no. I won't either. And those are great stories, but they sometimes can shift the emphasis in the wrong way. You know, the fundamental truth is that communists kept good archives. That was one of the communists kept, like, the archives of the Soviet Republic of Ukraine are much better organized than the archives of 20th century Austria. I spent a lot of time in both. Like, that's something no one would ever really believe, because everyone knows Austrians are very, you know, are so orderly. But in fact, okay, they're not, right? So the fundamental thing is that communists, first of all, left a lot on paper because they thought history was on their side. That was what Lenin did. So this is the way Lenin and even Stalin are quite different from Hitler. Hitler left very little on paper. He signed relatively little when it came to the kind of policies we're talking about. He tended to issue instructions orally. German officials tend to use euphemisms or the radio, you know, when they could. The Soviets wrote things down, and then they put those things in archives. And the fundamental thing, you know, I know you know this, I'm just dwelling on, the fundamental thing is that since 89 or 91, we've had access to a ton of that stuff. Much more has been available than hasn't been available. And we are really still now, 20 years later, working through all of that stuff, even as some of it has been closed off. In the early 90s, Russians, and Americans and Finns and other people published a lot of that. Some of what's now been published or microfilmed, and which is now scattered around libraries and archives in the West, has since been put out of reach. But we have it because in the meantime it was published. And those published collections are extremely valuable. But I'm getting to your question. I want to make it clear that the picture in terms of documents is really very, very, very good. You know, just to give you one example, I talk about the Polish operation. It's the second largest action of the Great Terror after the Kulak action was this Polish operation. In the early 1990s, it was a few Russians who found those documents, collected them, and published them, right? And it took the Poles another 20 years to catch up with that, interestingly enough, because you'd think the Poles would be really interested in this sort of thing. But the first book in Polish which discussed this was actually my book in Polish translation. And then the second book was published in Polish last year. So we get interesting stuff out of unexpected, what you might think are unexpected places. You know, the source of the greatest, actually the single largest mass killing operation against Poles are document collections published by Russians. And I want to, you know, try to distribute credit, because obviously I didn't myself do all the archival work for this book. I did some of it, but mostly it's hundreds of colleagues, you know, on whom I depend. Okay, but I will answer your question. In general, I had very good luck with archives in Poland. I had very good luck in Kiev. I found Kiev to be a pleasure to work in. Since late Yushchenko, things have gotten worse. Things are worse now under Yanukovych. The turn was actually late Yushchenko. And things have gotten considerably worse under Yanukovych. Lots of things that colleagues were working on, having to do with the Second War especially, are now no longer available. With Russia, Russia has been worse than Ukraine. In general, you saw a lot of graduate students sitting in Kiev writing dissertations about the Soviet Union, because so much important documentation was in Kiev, and Kiev was a much easier place to work with. But still, I would say, you can get to most of the stuff you want in Moscow. It requires an awful lot of patience. And sometimes a certain amount of, you know, flexibility in your personal relationships. But mostly, so I went for the laugh. I'm a bad person. The fundamental truth is that archivists, whether they're Russian or Ukrainian, they respect you if you go there day after day. That's the fundamental truth. Archival research is not a matter of showing up and there being this dramatic letter from Stalin. Archival research is a matter of sitting there day after day after day. And that tends to work wherever you are. So with that boring conclusion, bring this to an end. Thanks.
I will just note that there are books for sale outside, and also that we're having reception across the hall. And to thank you once again all for coming out, and thank our speaker for an extremely stimulating lecture.